tells me of a Savior's love. He died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells me what my Father hath in store for every day. And though I tread a darksome path, yield sunshine all the way. Oh, oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells of the one who saved me, can feel my deepest woe, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, because he first loved me.
One more hymn, number 511, 511, Face to Face with Christ my Savior. Face to face, what will it be? 511.
To face with Christ my Savior. Face to face, what will it be? When with rapture I behold him, Jesus Christ died for me. I shall behold him far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all his glory, I shall see him above and above.
Blessed day is coming when his glory shall
Face to face I shall behold him, far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all his glory I shall see him. Rejoicing in his presence, when our banished grief and pain, when the crooked ways are straightened, Jesus Christ, who I shall behold him, far beyond the starry sky, face to face in all his glory I shall see him by and above. Blissful moment, face to see and know, face to face with my Redeemer, Jesus Christ, who loves me so. I shall behold him, far beyond the starry sky, face to face in all his glory I shall see him by and above.
You may be seated. Ask Christy Strickland to please come up and share special music with us. When she is finished, Dan Nave and the board will come up and pray for the pastor, and then Dan will be sharing with us the message that God has given him. Christy.
when your pathway grows dim and you just can't see it, remember you're never alone. God is too wise to be mistaken.
Wonderful choice for a song. Thank you so much. I'm going to set this back here. Wanted to read some scripture to y'all this morning before we pray. I've asked the fellows to pray about some specific things, some specific people this morning. But before we do that, wanted to read some scripture to y'all. I cried out to God with my voice, to God with my voice, and he gave ear to me. In the day of my trouble, I sought the Lord. My hand was stretched out in the night without ceasing. My soul refused to be comforted. I remembered God and was troubled. I complained and my spirit overwhelmed me. Selah. That's Psalm 77. Asaph was in a time of trouble. And as bad as those verses sound at the beginning, then he says this: I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember your wonders of old. I will also meditate on all your work and talk of your deeds. Your way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God? You are the God who does wonders. You have declared your strength among the people. You have with your arm redeemed the people, the sons of Jacob and Joseph. And so we come to God sometimes with broken hearts, don't we? We come to God with needs, and humanly speaking, there's no answer. But God is still God. And so we're going to pray this morning. Pastor Tim will have, and by the way, Tim and Jill, you're watching this, we believe. We want you to know we love you. We'll be with you in our hearts tomorrow. Tim has a port installed tomorrow, and then chemo begins on Tuesday. This will be the first of 8 sessions of chemotherapy that will be about 2 weeks apart. So this will go for about 16 weeks. And we're trusting God to heal Pastor Tim. That's our prayer. In that time, there are needs. Tim certainly has needs. Jill, her heart is just aching. Emily, we're going to pray for Emily this morning. We want to pray for Tim's doctor, Dr. Thompson. And then there are huge financial needs, as you are aware. And so we want to pray for that. So, Dave, please, Dave's going to pray for Pastor Tim.
God, first, I just want to thank you for Tim, for all the years that he's put in here at this church. His whole adult life, he served you. And we just thank you for his faithfulness, his love and his compassion, so many hours that he's put in doing this. We just ask that you be with him, give him strength. We've already seen what you can do as he was in the hospital. There were things that happened that just confounded the doctors and didn't know where fluid had gone, and you took care of that. So we've already seen you work. We ask that you strengthen him through these next few weeks as he goes through the chemo. Just be with him and be with his family, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Father, we just thank you again for your faithfulness, that you're our creator, you're holy, you're a good God. Lord, we thank you for Jill. Just commit her to you, Lord. Give her strength and wisdom. Give her patience. Give her a joy that only you can provide as a caregiver or as in this situation, Lord. She needs your help. Just wrap her your arms around her. Love her as only you can. Lord, we pray that you'd meet her needs. Give her somebody that's a good listener, and help her to reach out to that person. And whoever that may be, Lord, help us as a church be good listeners and to love as only you can help us love. Lord, meet Jill where she's at. Encourage her and strengthen her. We ask these things in your name.
Father, we pray for Emily this morning, and just ask, Father, that you would comfort her heart. She watches her daddy go through this, Lord, and being a distance away and having to spend that time away from him even while he's in the hospital. And Lord, I pray that you would put someone in her life over there in Nashville to encourage her and to remind her that her hope is in you. Thank you for her testimony of faith in Christ. And God, we just ask your blessing on Emily's life as they travel this journey together. In Jesus' name.
Our Father, we tend to become complacent
You've met our needs, and suddenly our needs expand beyond all sight. We pray, God, that you put Tim's mind at ease. You are a God who provides. We pray that you provide financially for the needs that he will face. More than that, we pray that we might become part of that solution. God, we are a community, a body of believers. We pray for his finances at this time. And we thank you, God, that you can ease his mind and that you will provide according to your riches and glory. That's always been the case. He didn't know it last year. God, may he glorify you by what he does and what he sees and what he becomes as you form us into the image of your son. God, provide for him financially. It's a worry, it's a burden, particularly for husbands and fathers. Ease his mind, give him your peace beyond all understanding, we ask.
Father, we thank you so much for a pastor that loves you and loves your word. We also thank you for the many doctors that you have sent to us to heal those when we get ill, when we become ill. I am really, really thankful for your sovereignty and your authority. I remember in the sixth verse of Matthew, the eighth chapter, about the centurion. He asked you, Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed, dreadfully ill. And you said to him, I will come and heal him. But the centurion answered and said to you, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word and my servant will be healed. And Lord, you later responded in marvel. You've not found such a great faith, not even in Israel. So we just pray for faith for us, that you will say a word to the doctor, guide his hands and guide his every decision, and let us all, the family, all of us have faith. But we do understand your authority more than all of you. Your way, O Lord, not ours. Your will be done, not ours. Since you for us did bleed, and now doth intercede, each day we simply plead, thy will be done.
Thank you, Father, for letting us pray. And Lord, help us to just to trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, John. So I say, we will trust in God our Savior. Say it with me. We will trust in God our Savior. Turn your Bibles, if you would, please, to Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. And when you find it, in honor of God's word, would you stand with me? Philippians chapter 1. We'll begin reading in verse 12. Okay. Philippians 1, verse 12. But I want you to know, brethren, that the things which happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel, so that it has become evident to the whole palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Christ. And most of the brethren in the Lord, having become confident by my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ even from envy and strife, and some also from goodwill. The former preach Christ from selfish ambition, not sincerely supposing to add affliction to my chains, but the latter out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and in this I rejoice, yes, and will rejoice. Father, thank you for your word. Help us to understand it as we study it today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Philippians chapter 1 is an amazing introduction to this whole scenario of what's happening. A few years ago, Cheryl and I designed and built our dream house. I remember when the excavator came and I was going to build it myself. And I can remember seeing that big hole in the ground where the basement was going to be and thinking, what in the world have I done? Every big job seemed overwhelming. The plumbing, it was just overwhelming to me. The electrical, it was just overwhelming. The heating, in fact, our son Matt helped with the heating, and I remember saying to him at one point, well, have you learned anything in this process? And he said, yes, I'll never be a heating guy. It could have been overwhelming, but I knew the big picture. We had blueprints that instructed me for everything that needed to happen, and in the sequence they needed to happen. So there was a plan. There was a master plan for this thing. And I knew that the job wasn't going to last forever. We were working toward a goal. Every day as I worked on that house, we got a little closer. Because it's the big picture that counts. It's the big picture that helps us deal with the things that come into our lives, and frankly, the things that come into our churches. The Philippians needed this kind of reminder, and I suspect maybe North Point Church as well. Paul, as he was writing this, was most likely in jail, and he has real needs. The church, they had sent a love gift to Paul by the hand of a man named Epaphroditus, but then he got deathly sick. And they were all in danger of terrible discouragement. And so Paul reminds them to focus on the bond that they have. That was that last message that we looked at, the previous verses. They had this bond in Christ. Don't forget the bond that you have in Christ. And now begins to remind them of the big picture. What is really important to God. Ready? That Jesus Christ came to seek and save that which was lost. That's the big picture. As we work through this whole scenario with a desperately ill pastor in this church, the task is to figure out how to use this to help the lost come to Christ. That's the big picture. Sometimes we wonder what God is doing. Why did he allow this to come? In the last couple of days, I've been talking with a pastor whose church has been terribly hit with the coronavirus. I have at least 3 people in the church that have tested positive. One of them is in a huge family, so it affected like 5 families in the church who are all now in quarantine. And just yesterday, his associate pastor's wife got positive test results for her coronavirus test, and they're just wondering, you know, what is God doing? But it's always wise to remember that God's priority is the gospel of Jesus Christ. God's priority is not our comfort. It's good to have comfort, isn't it? I want comfort. I like to have a full belly. I like to have a warm place to sleep. I like it to have a place to run for cover when it rains and storms. But that is not God's priority. Jesus Christ and the gospel of Jesus Christ is God's priority. And so I think our task as a church is going to be to figure out how we can join, and I would say willingly join, and participate in what God is doing. He has commissioned Tim McMichael for a special job. We don't know how that's going to end up. We know how we want it to end up, but we really don't know how it's going to end up. But I do know this, that we can participate in what God is doing through this situation. And even though we didn't really expect that life and ministry would look this way, and frankly, listen, we don't have any choice except to participate in it. We got no choice. This is what God has said. But we can willingly participate. We can do that. And so what I want to talk about this morning is, even when life doesn't make sense, let's talk about what God's priority is and how that can help us participate with what God is doing. And the first thing we want to say is God's priority is not hindered by problems. All day yesterday, all during the night last night, I woke up a couple times thinking about this. I'm going to drive. We have a car that I don't usually drive when the weather's bad. And I thought, well, I'm going to drive the Camaro over to church tomorrow. And so I planned on it, you know, and I thought, well, it's a little dirty. I'm going to get up this morning and wash it before we go over there. It'll look nice. I went out there this morning. My priority was to drive the Camaro to church today, and it wouldn't start. My priority was one thing, but there was a problem. The car wouldn't start. I think it's fair and wise for us to say this: expect the unexpected. So let's look at some of the problems that Paul and this church were facing. Number one, in verse 12, was the problem of Paul's circumstances. Paul was most likely in Rome at the time of this writing. According to Acts chapter 28, verse 30, he was living in a rented house, and people were able to come. There are some people who think maybe he was somewhere else. I fall into the category of those who think he was in Rome. If that's the case, he was chained to a guard 24 hours a day. Possibly moved to a camp of some kind. We really don't know. The confinement of Paul in Rome was seen as bad news. But that wasn't a problem to God. In fact, look at what Paul says here in verse 12. I want you to know, brethren, that the things which have happened to me have turned out for the furtherance of the gospel. I want you to know. Now, he's kind of implying a misunderstanding here. I want you to know, folks, that this is not a problem. Well, it kind of was a problem. It was a problem to Paul. But he was still attempting to fulfill God's purpose in his life because he had a view of that big picture. So no matter where he was, no matter what was happening, no matter who he was with, Paul was going to attempt to join God in his work. Notice also that the ministry is not hurt by bondage. The ministry is not hurt by problems. 6 months ago, none of us would have ever dreamed our country would be where it is today. If you'd said to me 6 months ago, that's in February. If you said to me 6 months ago, in 6 months, you're going to be wearing masks at Walmart. You're not going to be able to go where you want. Some places you travel, you're going to have to be quarantined. That seemed unreal to us. Churches are going to be forbidden to worship. That would have seemed unreal to us. But that kind of an issue is not a problem with God. In fact, the ministry can be advanced. We're all thinking about ministry in a different way now than we were 6 months ago. I suspect you've had things rolling around in your noodle about how to do ministry and how to serve God, things that would have never come to your mind 6 months ago. How are we going to do this? How are we going to figure out how to worship? What are we going to do? But see, those things aren't issues with God because of the big problem, or the big issue, the big picture. So Paul says here, these things have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel. That word actually means to a greater degree. So these things that I'm going through have made ministry possible to a greater degree. It's not what we expect, certainly. The unexpected result was this one word, furtherance. This word furtherance was used by the Greeks to describe the process of taking a hammer and beating something out, flatten it, and it would stretch it out, it would lengthen it. Think about that. This problem that I'm going through, I'm in prison, I'm chained to a Roman guard, has actually beat the gospel out of me into them. It has stretched my ministry, that has furthered my ministry. Don't be discouraged by what I'm going through, because what I'm going through has made the gospel spread more than it was. One dictionary gives the definition of this word, furtherance, to lengthen out by hammering as a smith forges metal. That's what it means. You ever feel like you're getting beat with a hammer? Well, that's how God stretches our ministry. And it ain't fun. But it's how God makes us better. It's how God makes us better people. And it's how God makes us better churches, when he beats it into us. It actually means, theologically, this word, to make progress by trial. That's what it means. One commenter says, it's the increase, the promotion of the gospel. Instead of being a hindrance, this imprisonment, instead of being a hindrance, it has rather been an advantage. We have, as a church, the opportunity to talk about the gospel of Jesus Christ in different ways than we would have had 6 months ago or 6 weeks ago, because of what this church is going through. In times of trial, we don't want to look at what God didn't do or what God isn't doing. We want to look at what God will do. Go back to verse 6, where Paul said, I am confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work at North Point Church will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. There was also the problem of the Roman guard. For the Philippians, it looked hopeless. But for Paul, it looked like God was at work, because the guards saw what was happening in Paul's life. The chains, literally being chained to a soldier, gave him access to that soldier. Historically, we think they worked in 6-hour shifts. So 4 guards a day would be chained to Paul. It was well known that Paul wasn't a criminal. All the other people knew it. He says in verse 12, it's become evident to the whole palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Christ. He understands that his confinement, what he was going through, was really an attempt by the evil one to silence the message of Christ. Listen, do not let what we're going through silence the message of Christ. Let it advance the message of Christ. The word here, evident, and the word in Christ are connected together. Let me give you the Dan Nave free translation of this verse. So that the bonds of mine are plainly recognized in Christ by the whole headquarters and all the others. They all knew. They all knew that Paul was the one who said, I appeal to Caesar. They all knew that. His bonds weren't pieces of iron chained to his wrist or his ankle. That wasn't the bond of Christ. Paul was enslaved to Jesus Christ. And he was committed to serving Jesus Christ and making everything that happened in his life somehow turned around to honor Christ. There was also the problem of fear. Because fear is what keeps Christians from talking about Jesus. I don't know what else to say about that, so I'm not going to say anything else. Fear is what keeps us from talking about Jesus. But remember to expect the unexpected. And so God had turned circumstances around so that, look at what it says here in verse 14. Most of the Christians were no longer afraid, but they were bold. It means, the word bold means to not have fear. That's what it means. Literally, they were daring to speak now of Jesus Christ. And that's what we need to do. We need to dare to speak about Jesus Christ and weave the story of Jesus Christ into the conversation when you tell people about what your pastor is going through. Weave the story of Jesus Christ when you tell people about what North Point Church is going through and how y'all have handled the whole virus thing and what God is doing. Weave the story of Jesus Christ into that scenario. When you go through tough times, are people drawn to serve Christ by your attitude? That goes back to, I said we need to willingly. We're going to be involved. We are involved in this. But will we willingly participate? I think we need to understand that God's plan is way bigger for us than we can imagine. So we need to continue to do the right thing, even if we don't understand what's happening. Just hang on. 3 things about God's priority. 1 is that God's priority for us is not hindered by problems. 2, God's priority for us is not hindered, not affected by personalities. There are really only two kinds of believers: fleshly believers and fruit-bearing believers. It's that simple. And the choice is yours. You get to choose. Are you going to be a fleshly believer or a fruit-bearing believer? There's no in between. In verse 15 and 16, Paul talks about this. Apparently, the Philippians were discouraged by the preaching of the gospel by some people they didn't want preaching the gospel. As I get older, I'm trying to learn that there are people who God uses that I wouldn't choose. I think I've already told you about this. A few weeks ago, I connected with some guys I graduated with in high school. We graduated in 1973. That's how old I am. And through Facebook, one of them reached out to me, and he apparently saw on my Facebook page and figured out I was a Christian. And he reached out to me to meet in a Zoom meeting every week for prayer. So I've been doing that. And I'm looking at these other guys. There's about eight of us that do it. And I think, man, I never thought he'd be a Christian. And I'm thinking, they're probably thinking that about me. Never thought that Dan Nave guy was a Christian. So sometimes God uses people that we wouldn't choose. These here in this text, in verse 15, they preach from envy and strife. So they were preaching at least partially the right message, but they had the wrong motive. Likely they were believers. They just didn't like Paul. And so God was allowing the message to be preached. They were competitive. That's what envy and strife means. It means to compete. They wanted what Paul had. We preachers in modern America are really tempted with that, to want what, you know, the so-called successful guys have. The most godly, committed pastors that I know are not the celebrities. They're the Tim McMichaels of the world. That's the ones upon whom God lays his hand and chooses to use, sometimes even in desperately difficult circumstances. These are people who confuse petty differences with ministry. That's something else that I can't say that I've completely accomplished yet, but I want to learn. I describe it as, don't be a jerk. I just don't want to be a jerk in ministry. And so if there's something that you do, something a different way than I choose to do it, that's okay. You go ahead and do it. There were people who played politics. That's verse 16. They're the players in ministry. They seem to always have an opinion. Paul described them as people with selfish ambition. Electioneering is what it really means. And they will purposely hurt others to gain an audience. Self-seekers with no regard for anybody else. Jump over to chapter 2 and look at verse 4. Let each of you look out for not only your own interests, for the interests of others. So as we approach this church thing, if we approach it in our mind wanting everybody else to do well, I want to have your interest in mind before I put my interest in. If we all have that attitude, then everybody ends up serving everyone else. That's the fleshly kind of believer. But then there's the fruit-bearing kind of believer. The end of verse 15 and then also in verse 17, they serve with goodwill, satisfaction, The joy they get from serving Jesus is the only reward they want, fruit-bearing believers. They're motivated by love. Some from goodwill, he says here in verse 15. And then when you jump down to verse 17, they're motivated out of love. They know that Paul was appointed to the defense of the gospel. Now listen, if Paul is able to say, I was appointed to the defense of the gospel, it also means I was appointed to these chains. If we are appointed to the defense of the gospel, we are also appointed to the circumstances we're going through today. God specifically chose North Point Church and has specifically gifted North Point Church to go through the difficulties you're going through. You have the Holy Spirit of God guiding you and directing you. They're comfortable with God's call and God's blessing, and in context here, even on someone else's life. They understood what Paul's appointment was. And so Paul wanted the Philippians to not worry about the spokesman, about who the spokesman was. And he's not saying that it's okay to be a politician. That's not all what he's saying. God will deal with them, and so will Paul. Just like read 1 Corinthians. We'll figure that out. But that wasn't what bothered Paul. That wasn't his concern. His concern was for this church, and that God was able to get the message out, the gospel of Jesus Christ, through this church. People are about envy. People are about circumstances. People are about things. Paul really didn't care. Personalities mean nothing to him. So, we're talking about God's priority. It's not hindered by problems. It's not affected by personalities. And it is advanced only in the preaching of Christ. That's verse 18. Paul understood the big picture. Motives, no matter what they were, good, bad, indifferent, other people's motives weren't going to affect him. God will deal with that. The gospel was more important to Paul than who got credit for the gospel, for giving it. He understood that God was maybe even using people who didn't understand, who didn't like him. God was using people. And as long as they were preaching Christ, Paul didn't really worry about it, because his focus was on the gospel. The preaching of Christ. The gospel of Jesus. The most important thing. I think it bears repeating that the way we approach circumstances as individuals and as a church is to do it together. And with the understanding that God never... He never acts for no reason. God is always at work. So I think it's good for us, rather than ask why did God allow the coronavirus to infect our country? Why did God allow cancer to affect our pastor? I think rather than asking that, maybe we ought to ask how and what. How can this be used to point people for Christ? How will 16 weeks of chemotherapy, how can that be used to point people to Christ? What can we do as a church? What can we do together to demonstrate faith in Christ, and that the events or the lack of them aren't going to affect what North Point Church does? You have an amazing community here. People in your community need to know what's happening in this church. And they need to see that you're going to walk with Christ through. We have our freedom. Sometimes we live in slavery. You know, Paul was in chains. Yet he was free. In his mind, he was free as a bird, even though he was in chains. Your chains, our chains here at North Point Church, are these circumstances that we're going through, but they are our freedom. We have more opportunities and new opportunities and different opportunities to explain the goodness of Jesus Christ to people that we didn't have 6 months ago. When you're in prison, like Paul was in prison, the little things don't matter. It was the big picture. For Paul, it was the gospel of Christ and how he might advance it. Many of you know that a little over five years ago, Cheryl was almost killed in an accident, a fall on the mountain behind our house. And they used a helicopter and they flew her to the University of Tennessee Medical Center. And I remember very vividly, I have a picture of it, in fact, of Cheryl in the trauma center there. And we had this conversation. I don't know if you even remember it, Cheryl, but we had this conversation. Why does God have us here? We had just started this new ministry, you know, 9 months earlier, had just moved and started over. Why, God, do you have us here? And we prayed right in the trauma center, right over there in Knoxville. We prayed, God, whatever you're doing, use it for Christ. So, in the old days, before coronavirus, and, you know, there would be a lot of people in the hospital. It's not so much that way anymore, but then it was. And when you're in an intensive care unit, you know, everybody who's there doesn't want to be, and including the family. And so there's a big waiting room. If you've ever been in a situation like that, there's a huge waiting room. And there's easy chairs and lounge chairs that kind of fold back. And so people will sleep there. They'll give you blankets and pillows and you sleep there. What happens is those family members who have loved ones in the ICU, those people, they have a bond. We have a bond together with other people in the waiting room. And I made friends with a lady whose husband had been in a terrible car accident and was almost killed. And so they were kind of trying to help him get healthy. And so we, you know, we chatted, we talked a lot, we prayed, and I didn't even remember her name, to be truthful with you. A few weeks after Cheryl was hurt, my dad was diagnosed with a brain tumor. So this happened when Cheryl fell, and I was in the waiting room in the intensive care. That was the end of June that year. In the end of September, my dad was there, having brain surgery. Now, I always got a rotten phone signal inside the building at UT Medical Center, so I was down outside in the circle talking to some people on the phone, and I heard someone yelling at me, and it was that woman. Her husband was back in the hospital for a follow-up surgery. Now, you tell me, is that a coincidence? We were in the hospital together 6 months ago, and now it's even a different person in my life. It's my dad, not my wife. He's having surgery, and they're back the same day for surgery again. And I saw this lady running to me, you know, through the parking lot, and she embraced me, and she said, "You're the guy who prayed for my husband when he was hurt. I want to take you upstairs and introduce you." So we went up to his room. And we went into the room, and she said, "This is the man that I told you about who prayed for you when you almost died." You will never know how God can use you when your life stinks. We'll never know. this side of eternity, we may never know how God is going to use North Point Church during this time. But I promise you, if you walk with Him, He will use you. The doctors, the nurses, your neighbors, other people in town, the people you work with, tell them what God is doing in your life. Tell them that your pastor is sick and that you're trusting Jesus. And God will bless your lives in ways you can't imagine. Father, thank you for this time. I thank you for this passage of Scripture, and I thank you for this church. I thank you for Pastor Tim, and for Jill, and for Emily. And Lord, we want them to know that they are not walking alone. Not only do they have us, they have Jesus Christ. And so while we're afraid, there is no need to fear, because the one who created the world holds our hand. The one who gave his son, Jesus Christ, who died on a cross an awful death, the one who raised Jesus from the dead, holds our hand. And if God can raise Jesus from the dead, He can hold our hand through this. Help us, Lord, to trust you. In Jesus' name.
Soldiers of Christ, arise and put your armor on. Hymn number 403. Let's stand and sing the first and the third verse. 403.
Soldiers of Christ,
church, go forth. On your way out the entry,